Last time on Dragon Ball Z, Frieza is no more. The Frieza Force rebelled against the evil Emperor thanks to the likes of Zarbon, Ginyu, and King Vegeta. However, the celebrations are short-lived for the Saiyans as Paragus, who led a battalion during the final battle, betrayed the king, pronouncing himself as the new king of the Saiyans. His first order of business is to imprison the young King Vegeta in a cell under the castle. An outright civil war begins to brew in the renamed planet, now called Planet Paragus. Bardock and a few others chose to band together to take down the new king, seeing him as nothing but ruthless, lacking the honor that King Vegeta had. The Saiyan race is divided now. Galactic Civil War! What if the Frieza Force rebelled? Part 2.
Planet Paragus. It's nothing like it used to be. It had only been a few months since the last battle against Frieza, but everything had changed in that time. King Paragus sat alone on his throne, light shining through the broken roof and onto his face. He sighed. Several meters under him, the young Prince Vegeta sat on his knees, powerless. Around his neck was a shock collar, similar to Broly's. In front of him was Broly himself, who just stared at the knocked out prince. He was surrounded by scorch marks from the various times the prince had tried to blast them through his mouth. They finally ended up gagging him with a mouth guard. The prince was completely defenseless and very hurt. Broly was tasked with keeping an eye on him at all times. After all, he was the strongest fighter around. The young Saiyans were unaware of the rebellion beginning. In the lower levels of Planet Vegeta, Bardock and his squad held secret meetings. Together, they devised a plan to get the king out of the throne. However, too many Saiyans were loyal to him. They saw Paragus and Broly as war heroes, and wouldn't turn on him easily.
We have to rescue Prince Vegeta. That's the only way we can inspire others to join us. He'll be a symbol.
How can you be sure that it'll work?
I'm not, but it's one of our only chances.
All of the warriors around Bardock looked at him worried, and Gine caressed his cheek. He had gained new battle scars since this all began. They had been forced out of their homes for not agreeing to kneel in front of the new king. Paragus was ruthless, sending all the elites off to die in various worlds, torturing the prince, etc. He only kept the most loyal ones to him. He even began a search party to look for Tarble, Vegeta's younger brother, with the sole purpose of torturing him. Thankfully, Paragus was running low on scouters. Without Frieza to supply them, they were blind to attacks, and likewise, couldn't find the rogue Saiyans. Zarbon did try to help a little, as he respected him, and found the civil war entertaining. But he was always busy with the power vacuum left behind by the death of Frieza. Some remained loyal to the family, and King Cold was not happy with his son's death. He saw the Saiyans as useless monkeys that would eventually kill themselves off, but cared much more about the likes of Zarbon, Ginyu, and Kikono. The civil war was destructive, mainly because of how unorganized everyone was. While some did follow Bardock, others tried to take down the king on their own. In fact, Shugesh, one of Bardock's squadmates, grew tired of waiting and attempted to attack the castle on his own. Broly and Paragus quickly killed him. The Saiyans spread it out in the underground to rest, while Gine and Bardock sat behind a curtain on their bed, quietly. The two didn't speak for a few minutes, until Gine burst out in tears. Bardock held her close.
I know. I wish it wasn't this way. Kakarot on another planet, and Raditz.
Gine's cries became louder, and the next morning, Bardock finished telling the Saiyans about his plan. They had been training for a few months now, right under the king's nose. They have all gotten stronger, but still not close to the elite's powers. Saiyans don't usually train because of their natural strength being enough for most foes, but these were dire circumstances, and they were forced to do it. King Paragus was losing it day by day as he called down his elites to bring up a low-class Saiyan for him to beat on. Bardock and the others watched from far away as they took Tora. Bardock clenched his fist, angry, but he couldn't do anything. He was lucky enough about the lack of scouters not alerting the king about their power-up. He couldn't risk it. Bardock was going to say something, he had to. But then, he met Tora's eyes. They were defiant, ready to face the king. Bardock realized that this may be good for their cause. As soon as they were gone, Bardock and the other Saiyans went on two separate ships towards the castle. While one went to the back, the other went to the front. Gine Borgos and a handful of other Saiyans came out of their ship to the front of the castle.
We are here to talk to the king about our next mission.
Get out of here, low class!
Meanwhile, Bardock, Fasha, and others opened the ship doors, peeking through it while watching from the outside of the stained glass window. They watched as the king drags the already hurt Tora towards the back, going down the stairs. The ship moves around to look for another window, seeing how the king and Tora enter a chamber. And at the other end of the hall, Bardock sees Broly going into a different room. They can't enter from there, so they went around to another window, the dining room.
What do you mean your husband's a great scientist? Isn't he that low-class warrior Bardock?
She meant her sister's husband. He works with the incubators we wanted to drop off food.
Yeah, whatever. I said out!
An explosion comes from the inside and the guards turn around, alarmed.
What the?
Gine slams her fist against the guard's jaw, while Borgo smashed his head against the other guard. The team ran inside to meet more guards, and the battle began. Meanwhile, Paragus continued beating Tora. The explosion from above was drowned out by the punches against Tora's face, but he did notice some rumbling. He decided to go out, but he had to land one last punch against Tora. When he turned around to punch him in the face, Tora grabbed Paragus' fists and blasted him back. At the same time, Bardock and his team had just blasted through the dining room. He stopped dead on his tracks as he looked up to see King Vegeta's armor hanging above the throne, with the hole Paragus had blasted through him in the middle of the chest. There was no time to waste. Gine and her team kept the guards busy, though they were slowly getting overwhelmed. Bardock and his team ran down the steps towards the room where Tora was being kept. Fasha kicked the door down, but the king was nowhere to be found. It was just a bloodied up Tora with a broken arm.
I got him good, guys. He's quite hurt. He couldn't have gone far. What happened to you? He called down Broly. It's a miracle I'm not dead. But Bardock, that kid just wanted to protect his dad. Quiet, Tora. It's okay. You'll be okay. No, Bardock. This is it for me. It's up to you guys now.
Tora's eyes blanked out as he passed out. Though not dead yet, he was close to it. Bardock held his dying friend in his arms. As he put him down, he saw all the blood on his hands. Bardock was seeing red in pure rage. He unwrapped the bandage around Tora's arm, which was soaking up blood. Bardock then wrapped it around his forehead, ready to avenge his friend. He told Leek to stay behind with him as Bardock and the others ran towards the dungeon at the other side of the hall. Gine and her team was slowly being pushed back, but they had to hold them off from getting close to Bardock's team. Just then, Gine was hit by a blast that sent her flying back. She looked up to see just who hit her, and she was horrified. It was Raditz, her own son. She knew that he had joined Paragus, just like many other younger Saiyans. Gine begged her son to join them, but he wasn't listening. To him, Paragus was a war hero. He didn't see just how ruthless he was towards his own people. At least King Vegeta had honor. Gine didn't want to fight her son, but there was little choice for her since she was being attacked. But a battle began between the two. Borgo stepped in. He didn't like the idea of Gine fighting her own son, so at the very least, he could help. Elites joined Raditz as they fought the two Saiyans. As Bardock and Fasha went through the halls, they ran into Nappa, guarding the door where Vegeta was being held. Bardock landed a solid punch against his face, but Bardock stopped the second punch. He looked at them sullenly.
I couldn't save him on my own. I'll join you.
They were surprised, but they knew Nappa had a liking for the prince. Great, the more the merrier. They finally opened the door up, but Bardock was met with a powerful punch against his face as soon as he opened the door. Inside was a hurt Paragus holding his hand against the prince's forehead, ready to blast them.
Rebel scum! Why do you want this brat anyways? Prince Vegeta! It's over, Paragus. We're tired of your tyranny.
But Bardock looked up to see who had punched him. It was Broly. They all knew of his legendary power. For such a young kid, he was so powerful. What could they do? Fasha goes in to attack Broly along with Nappa, but they are both hurled out. They're gonna try again, but Bardock stops them. Slowly, he walks up to Broly. He was biting his tongue, keeping his emotions about Tora in check.
Broly, I know you don't like hurting people. You just want to protect your dad, right? We're not gonna hurt him. Don't listen to him, son. He's a traitor. He wants to take your future throne.
Paragus pointed his hand out to Bardock, away from Vegeta. This gave him a chance to smash his elbow against Paragus' chest, knocking him down. Nappa and Fasha blasted the two chains holding Vegeta, and the prince fell to his knees. He was skinny and badly hurt. No doubt, Paragus had forced Broly to use him to train. Broly turned around to see his dad on the ground, but he was fine. And Paragus stood up. Nappa grabbed onto Vegeta. Paragus tried to electrocute Vegeta, but Bardock blasted the remote control away. Although Paragus told Broly to stop them, his son just ran over to him and checked if his father was doing okay. Paragus pushed him away. Gine and Raditz's fight continues as more Saiyans begin to fall, but the cavalry had arrived. Bardock, Nappa, Fasha, and even Vegeta began to fight against those loyal to Paragus. But Bardock tried to get his son To his surprise, Gine and Borgos were both badly hurt on the ground, with Raditz ready to blast them. Although he was young, he was still powerful for his age. Additionally, a handful of other Saiyans helped them through the battle. As he was about to kill them both, Bardock jumped in front of the blast, burning his arm. Bardock didn't want to fight his son, but he had truly been brainwashed by Paragus. He asked if they had killed the king, but Bardock stayed quiet. Raditz goes in for an attack again, but Bardock disappears and reappears behind his son, hammering his fist against Raditz's back. This knocked him out instantly, and Bardock threw him over his shoulder. Just then, Bardock was hit with multiple ki blasts on the back. He falls to the ground, and Gine screams his name. Suddenly, the attacks stop, and all the remaining elites are blasted away. Bardock turns around to see Broly, who yelled at them to escape. Without a word, the surviving members of Bardock's rebellion fly off to the lower levels of Planet Vegeta, followed by Broly. They had to bring the prince to the Saiyans, show them that there's still hope, an alternative to Paragus. Far above the castle, the blue figure of Zarbon watched the battles go down with a smirk. Saiyans were very entertaining. As the Saiyans landed down on the village, every other Saiyan that wasn't part of the rebellion cheered loudly. They saw the prince land down. They lifted him up, calling him king, and Bardock declared him so. Though some questioned it, most agreed that Vegeta was the rightful new king. Broly smiled at him too, although Vegeta looked at him quietly. No way he could forgive him for the attacks. Broly stepped back at the look. Leek put a hand on Bardock's shoulder and put his head down. Tora had not survived. Bardock sighed, putting a hand on his headband. But Tora gave up his life for something good. Now they could all rest, and arrest the king when Broly wasn't around.
King? King? I am your king!
Paragus flew down, looking over the crowd. He was ready to attack them all, but the crowd instead began to throw things at him, and shooting ki blasts. Boos erupted. Paragus had really just threatened them. Broly begged them to stop, but the crowd began to cheer for Vegeta to kill Paragus. Vegeta laughed, his adrenaline rushing. Bardock tried to stop him, but Paragus blasted at the crowd, and Vegeta did so right back, with a Gallic gun. Even hurt, Vegeta was a huge force to deal with, and Paragus was killed. The blast traveled all the way to the castle, exploding it. Cheers got louder, but Bardock ran over to Broly and tried to calm him down. They knew of his angry power, but they weren't ready for this. Lightning struck the ground and Broly screamed out. Everyone was pushed away. When they looked back up, they saw the true power of legend. The legendary Super Saiyan. The crowd screamed in fear, but Fasha, Borgos, Nappa, and Leek stood tall in front of Vegeta to defend them. But without moving a finger, Broly's aura pushed away all the Saiyans from the king. Gine held tight to the unconscious Raditz as she watched Broly knee Vegeta's stomach. All the Saiyans tried to attack him, but it looked as if it didn't hurt him at all. Vegeta fell to the ground in pain, spitting out blood. Even while captured, he wasn't afraid. But this scared him. Bardock slid in front of Broly with his arms out.
Broly, stop! Your father was a tyrant! Vegeta simply...
Broly grabbed Bardock by the neck, slamming him against the ground, creating a crater. Gine screamed out one more time. Broly shifted his view back up to look at Vegeta, but he wasn't there. So instead, Broly began to focus on the other Saiyans, blasting at them, beating them down. Nobody stood a chance against Broly. In a last-ditch effort, Nappa created an artificial moon. Vegeta's and Broly's tails were both cut off by Paragus, so they didn't transform. Gine ran inside a house with Bardock in order to not transform and not lose consciousness, taking care of Raditz. Everyone else began to go mad. Some elites could control it, but it was chaos all around. Some focused on Broly, but even with multiple Ozarus, Broly's Super Saiyan power was too much. Vegeta watched the destruction and death from above.
You lot never change. Lord Frieza did say you'd be your own undoing.
Vegeta turned around to see Zarbon.
I can tell you're worried, Prince. That Super Saiyan power was truly something Frieza was rightful in being afraid of. Pity. It would have been useful against King Cold, but if I can't use it...
Zarbon grabbed Vegeta by the hair, chucking him down to the middle of the Ozara War, where he landed next to Broly.
Then no one can.
Zarbon went into his ship, flying away from the planet. Those Saiyans could kill themselves. No way the planet could withstand another Ozaru rampage. Vegeta looked up. He tried to fight off the Ozarus, since most of them were nothing compared to his power. But Broly blasted him up to the sky easily. Vegeta couldn't believe it. He was the king for only a few minutes. If his kingdom was going to go down, it would go down his way.
If I can't have my kingdom, if I have to be outshined by a nobody, then at least I will take you all down with me!
Vegeta threw down a giant blast of ki with every single bit of his power. It pierced through the planet, and all the Ozarus followed suit, blasting down at the planet. Monkey see, monkey do. Gine and Bardock grabbed onto Raditz, rushing to space pods nearby, trying to not look at the moon. It was only a matter of time, but as Planet Vegeta began to explode, Broly did as much as he could to defeat all the Ozarus around him. One by one they fell, until there was finally only a handful left. But Broly was getting tired. He simply landed and walked to his father. Looking over, he saw Vegeta's body laying next to it. He had fallen unconscious after using all his power. Two dead kings on the same night. Broly closed his eyes as Planet Paragus, nay, Planet Vegeta, exploded. Zarbon had bigger matters to attend to than just silly Saiyans. There was a power vacuum created by Frieza since he died, and above that, King Cold could show up any day. Was it the right choice to kill Frieza? He only regretted not seeing Broly's true powers sooner. He could have used them. Thanks for watching, guys. I hope you enjoyed this video, and thanks for the positive response to the last part, and above that, the positive response to what if Vegeta and Goku went back in time. That one has been doing surprisingly well, and you guys liked it a lot. So if you haven't checked out that video, be sure to check it out. But what did you guys think of this one? Do you think Bardock and Gine survived the explosion? I didn't give you an answer on purpose. Anyways, guys, be sure to like, share, comment, and subscribe, and click the bell icon so you get notified when I upload new videos. Shout out to these guys who answer the Dragon Ball question of the week. The Dragon Ball question of the week this week is, if you could create your own Dragon Ball Ki Blast, what would you name it and what would it look like? Leave it in the comments down below and start a discussion. Anyways, until we meet again. See ya!
Don't forget to like, comment, and subscribe to SmugStick, unless you want to be destroyed.
Lord Beerus, that's hardly fair. But also, don't forget to click the bell icon to get notified when he uploads new videos.